you're doing on it?
Well, at our Texas Children's Center for Vaccine Development at Baylor College of Medicine, we've been doing this now for 2 decades, developing low-cost global health vaccines, mostly focused around disease targets that no one else wants to take on, because when they're complicated often, but second, they're diseases that generally affect only the poorest of the poor. We've made some progress in terms of shaping vaccines and getting them to clinical trials. But then about a decade ago, we recognized coronaviruses were going to be of enormous pandemic potential. And at that time, nobody was really very interested in coronavirus vaccines. So we adopted it. We started partnering with the New York Blood Center, together with the Galveston National Laboratory and Walter Reed. And we wrote an NIH grant that was funded. And we wound up developing vaccines for the first coronavirus of a pandemic potential, SARS or SARS-1 in 2003, that emerged out of Southern China, then Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome, MERS, so that when we saw the sequence of the SARS-2 coronavirus that causes COVID-19, and the Chinese scientists that put this up on a preprint server known as BioArchive, we realized that we can move pretty fast in terms of developing a third coronavirus vaccine for COVID-19. And our scientists worked under incredibly difficult circumstances. And this is a group that's co-led by my science partner of 20 years, Dr. Mary Elena Batazzi. And they worked day and night under difficult circumstances because, as you remember, if you remember back in the spring, they weren't allowing many businesses to be open. We had special permission because we were working on COVID-19. They worked in record time in building on all of the experiences, the successes and failures that we had with previous coronavirus vaccines to move pretty quickly. And now this is, we signed an agreement with BioE or Biological E based in India and Hyderabad. And they are now scaling this up to 1.2 billion doses, testing it across India. So it's very exciting for us to make a contribution. We've never made a billion of anything before, so that's pretty exciting also. But the point is, this is a very traditional technology, the same technology used to make the recombinant hepatitis B vaccine, used all over the world, and that's important for two reasons. One, many countries have the ability to make their own hepatitis B vaccine, so that potentially our vaccine could be made locally. It doesn't depend on it being made in Europe or the US and then filtering to the low and middle income countries. And it could be made pretty inexpensively, we think, so that hepatitis B vaccine in many cases is made for under $1 a dose. So we think our vaccine could come along in a similar cost structure.
President Trump is taking credit for Project Warp Speed and for fast-tracking the vaccine research. And I'm wondering how much credit you give him directly, as opposed to the career scientists at the CDC, NIH, NIAID. And maybe you can mention one or two of the things that you think he's done wrong and done right.
Well, no question. None of this would have happened without carefully thought out infrastructure by the National Institutes of Health and our fantastic research universities and institutes that made all of this possible. Exactly how Operation Warp Speed was assembled, I don't have a lot of details about that. I will say the individuals chosen, Mansoor Slawi and General Gus Perna, looks like they've done a very good job. Monsep, I've known for a while. He came out of GlaxoSmithKline vaccines. He's been in our laboratory. He's a very smart vaccine guy and has done what looks like a really good job so far in leading that. The only piece that I would say that has not happened that I would have liked to see more of is more of a communication strategy coming out of Operation Warp Speed. The communications has been very much left to the pharma CEOs, and I think overall they've not done a good job communicating to the American people. First of all, too much reliance on press releases that over this past year have been sometimes hard to decipher or understand. Too many leaked phone calls, too much weirdness about the stock trading and options, and I think that has undermined Operation Warp Speed, very much like the way Andrew Cuomo did in March and April. It doesn't have to be every day, but on a regular basis. I mean, I've done what I can to fill in those gaps, being on various cable news networks and podcasts. But, you know, at the end of the day, I'm not a government scientist, so I'm a medical school professor and call it as I see it, but I don't have the accountability of being a government scientist. So I think that's been a weakness.
So you've spoken about how scientists from competing pharmaceutical companies and your own group are cooperating with each other, at least to some degree, sharing information for the greater good. President Trump, on the other hand, has been calling the virus the China virus, which is not in the spirit of cooperation. He's pulled out of the World Health Organization, also not in the spirit of that kind of cooperation that you're talking about. Do you think that that has limited in any way what we or other countries are able to do in the development of a vaccine? What are the problems that may have been caused by, for instance, pulling out of the World Health Organization?
Well, I think the scientists are still sharing information and communicating at an international level, so I don't think that's been too affected. The thing that I worry about now is people have tied national identities to vaccines. In fact, there's a new term that's been coined called vaccinationalism, where you talk about the Chinese vaccine, the Russian vaccine, the British vaccine, the American vaccine. We've never had that before, and I think it's counterproductive. And so by the U.S. pulling out of the World Health Organization and refusing to be a part of the COVAX sharing facility, which is our new mechanism that's been put in place to provide global equity for vaccines, I think this has been counterproductive and could hold us back. We also now have this unfortunate situation where countries that don't have full access to vaccines are now making one-off deals with the Russians, the Chinese, and it has kind of a Cold War smell to it, and we have to fix that as well. I've been devoted my whole life to this concept of vaccine diplomacy, sharing vaccine development practices between countries, and I have served that role as U.S. science envoy in the Obama administration. I think we have to get back to that.
Let me reintroduce you. If you're just joining us, my guest is Dr. Peter Hotez. He's the co-director of the Center for Vaccine Development at Texas Children's Hospital and dean of the National School of Tropical Medicine at Baylor College of Medicine in Houston. We'll talk more after a break. This is Fresh Air.
After the turkey, do you plan to watch a game or play one? This year, more are passing up the Cowboys for a queen and trading the Ravens for a rook, thanks to a nudge from Netflix.
I can control it. I can dominate it. And it's predictable.
Jess is having a moment. I'm Jen Wood. See the whole board next time on 1A. Weekdays at 2 on AM 820 WNYC.
This is Fresh Air. So let's get back to my interview with Dr. Peter Hotez. He's the co-director of the Center for Vaccine Development at Texas Children's Hospital and author of the forthcoming book, Preventing the Next Pandemic, Vaccine Diplomacy in a Time of Anti-Science. It's expected to be published early next year. He's working on the development of a COVID-19 vaccine. The CDC recently released new suggestions about mask wearing. We had been told that wearing masks protects other people from you spreading the disease, from the mask wearer spreading the disease. But now we're being told that it's effective, not terribly effective, but somewhat effective in protecting the person wearing the mask from other people who might be spreading the disease. What's your understanding about how much wearing a mask can protect you against getting COVID?
Well, we have new estimates now from the Institute for Health Metrics and Evaluation at the University of Washington, really looking at the number of deaths that are going to be projected to result from COVID-19, and they're pretty chilling numbers. And it says that unless we can get to 95% mask wearing, we're looking at another 150,000 Americans who will lose their lives between now and a week or two after the inauguration. So we have this stunning number and a terrible terrible way of 400,000 Americans losing their lives between a week or so after the inauguration. You know, that's basically the number of American GIs who died in World War II. We're looking at those kinds of numbers. And, you know, for me, the tragedy is none of those people have to die. If we, you know, adhere to 95% mask wearing, number one. Number two, social distancing, especially in times when there's a threat of a big surge on intensive care units. Because remember, that's when the mortality figures go way up. We saw this in New York in March and April. We saw it in Southern Europe, in Italy, and Spain in March and April. The death rates really accelerate as ICU staff starts to get overwhelmed, and that's already starting to happen now in the northern Midwest and in Lubbock and El Paso here in Texas. So just by those straightforward measures, social distancing, being responsible, wearing masks, we can save tens of thousands of American lives between now and the time of the inauguration. And that has to be our big emphasis. One of the things that I've been trying to explain to general audiences is, look, in the past, when I've asked people to wear masks and do the social distancing, prevent the ICU surges, I never had a bracket on the right-hand side. I was never able to say that, look, in the past, I've said, please do this and we'll figure out something later. Now we have something very concrete to say. I can say, we have good vaccines coming. If you can keep your mother, your father, your brother, or sister alive for the next, just for the next 2-3 months, we can start getting them vaccinated and they will live a normal lifespan. This is not a time to be reckless or careless or defiant or tying political allegiance to protesting COVID prevention measures. This is a time to save the lives of your loved ones. And it's been really exasperating when we're seeing so many refuse to understand that straightforward point.
How soon do you think a vaccine will be available? I've been hearing different estimates. What's your understanding?
Well, the Pfizer is now applying for emergency use authorization. It'll take 2 or 3 weeks for the FDA and the affiliate committees to review that information. And I think we could start releasing vaccine to selected populations by the middle of December. And then remember, other vaccines are coming along. We'll have, following the Pfizer vaccine, the Moderna, the AstraZeneca Oxford vaccine in the U.S., we'll have the J&J vaccine, so that by the early part of next year, we're going to move pretty quickly, I think, in vaccinating a significant percentage of the population. Over the weekend, Mansoor Slawi, who heads Operation Warp Speed, felt that we could reach herd immunity, meaning 70% of the U.S. population through vaccines by as early as the spring. I think that's a bit aspirational. I don't think we'll quite get there, but you get the idea. I think we're going to move pretty quickly now in vaccinating a significant percentage of the U.S. population, provided all of the 3 or 4 stars that we need to align actually align.
And so your advice is, don't see this as an opportunity to take risks. What you want to do is make sure you survive long enough to get the vaccine. It's a reason to protect yourself until the vaccine is ready.
That's right. It's especially tragic if one of your loved ones loses their life or is permanent long-lasting injury during this period, because it's just a matter of staying disciplined for the next couple of months and getting them to the other side, and we get them vaccinated, they can live a normal life. This is not a time to be defiant. This is not a time to be reckless. This is a time to take this virus seriously and realize that now we have an end to this through vaccination.
And this is especially important advice during the holidays. Do you think people should, like, not go visit family and friends during Thanksgiving and Christmas, much as they want to?
Yeah, we all have to make some tough decisions. I know we like to be together. Families like to be together over the holidays, Thanksgiving and Christmas and other holidays. This may not be the year to do it. With this much virus circulating in the country right now, remember, the U.S. is the epicenter of the COVID-19 pandemic. these are the highest COVID transmission rates in the world. And what that means, practically speaking, is in any time you have a large gathering of people, whether it's in airports or bus stations or train stations, any public venue, there's going to be lots of COVID-infected individuals there. This is not a time to travel. This is a time to prepare for future Thanksgivings and Christmases ahead by protecting your loved ones.
Let me reintroduce you here. If you're just joining us, my guest is Dr. Peter Hotez, co-director of the Center for Vaccine Development at Texas Children's Hospital. He's working on the development of a COVID-19 vaccine, and he's the author of the forthcoming book, Preventing the Next Pandemic, Vaccine Diplomacy in a Time of Anti-Science. That's expected to be published early next year. We'll be back after we take a short break. I'm Terry Gross, and this is Fresh Air. NPR comes from this station and from Capital One, offering reimagined banking to fit people's lives, like Capital One Cafes, where customers can grab coffee, bank, and chat with an ambassador. What's in your wallet? More at CapitalOne.com. And from Duolingo, a language learning app built around the idea that learning should be fun. With more than 34 languages, including endangered languages, Duolingo is available as an app for download. On the next, our conversation with chef and activist Alice Waters and her daughter, curator Fanny Fair, to talk about her memoir, always called A Daughter's Recipes and Stories. Plus, the no-law people from serving dim sum and dumplings since 1920. Wilson Tang, owner and operator, joins us to talk about the no-law cookbook. I'm Allison Stewart. Join me for all of it. Weekdays at noon on WMYC. For WMYC comes from Optimum Business, offering secure internet with smart Wi-Fi, mobile, and tech support. More information about internet and voice bundles at 866-218-1816 or optimum.com/business.
It's WMYC. Good evening, folks. There's more Fresh Air just ahead here on AM 820. At 10 o'clock, the world of the PBS NewsHour is at 11 p.m. And be sure to join us tomorrow morning for the next Brian Mayer Show. We'll hear from former New York Governor David Patterson, as he remembers David Dinkins, the city's first and so far only black mayor, who died yesterday. Plus, the show's community well-being series continues with the group We Run Brownsville, which encourages women in the Brooklyn neighborhood to take control of their physical, mental, and emotional wellness. Tune into the Brian Lehrer Show, that's tomorrow morning at 10. You can listen on both 93.9 FM or AM 820. You can also ask your smart speaker to play WMYC. Tonight, increasing clouds. We'll have a low of about 40 degrees this evening. Tomorrow, Wednesday, mostly cloudy in the daytime, high reaching 55 by the afternoon. We'll likely to see some rain tomorrow night, probably starting after midnight. The temperature is going to inch up a few degrees tomorrow evening. And then on Thanksgiving, rain through the day, the high getting up to a nice balmy 58 degrees by the afternoon on Thanksgiving. Should be partly sunny by Friday with the high near 59 degrees. You're listening to WMIC. It's 9:30.
This is Fresh Air. I'm Terry Gross. Let's get back to my interview with Dr. Peter Hotez, who recorded it Monday. He's working on developing a vaccine for COVID-19. He's a co-director of the Center for Vaccine Development at Texas Children's Hospital and dean of the National School of Tropical Medicine at Baylor College of Medicine in Houston. Much of his career has been devoted to developing vaccines for neglected, poverty-related tropical diseases. He's the author of the forthcoming book, Preventing the Next Pandemic, Vaccine Diplomacy in a Time of Anti-Science. It's expected to be published early next year. What are some of the things you're hoping the Biden administration will do? And I know that you think federal guidance to states, to governors, is very important. Is that something President Trump chose to do? Why is that federal guidance important, and what kind of guidance are you hoping the Biden administration provides?
I think one of the most important is actually leading a federally coordinated response. I think what we saw all this year in the Trump administration was putting the states in the lead, and the U.S. government would be responsible for backup supply chain management and FEMA support and manufacturing ventilators and that sort of thing. And it didn't work, and this is why the U.S. has led the world in terms of COVID-19 deaths. And the reason it didn't work is the states never had epidemiologic horsepower to even know how to conduct COVID control measures. And they also needed the political cover of the federal government to deflect from the attacks that they were getting from their own internal political opposition. So this, I think having a federally coordinated response, which the Biden administration seems committed to, will make a big difference. The other thing that I've recommended is, given how disastrous the White House Coronavirus Task Force has been, particularly on Scott Atlas leading things and leading that aggressive disinformation campaign claiming that COVID-19 deaths were not due to COVID-19 but other causes, or discrediting masks or fake concepts of herd immunity, I would say the response, the leadership of the response, needs to be taken out of Washington and put firmly in control of the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. Move it to Atlanta. This is why the American people pay $11 billion a year in taxes to the CDC. Put them firmly in charge. There may be some internal deficiencies that have to be corrected, because we did see mistakes in 2020, missing the virus entry from Europe into New York and the problem with the testing. Fix that component, but put the CDC firmly in charge, I think, is going to be really important. And finally, if we're going to really achieve that 70% herd immunity, which is what our estimates that we came up with together with our colleagues at City University of New York, led by Bruce Lee, who's a friend and colleague of the